Well, a very warm welcome this afternoon to Trinity at 4. It's great to see you. Special welcome if you're visiting, and especially if you're here for the baptism of Harriet Clough. We're going to begin in just a minute. Most of what you need will be on the screen, both for the baptism and for communion that we're going to share in later together as well. Now, in just a moment, we're going to say some words together from Psalm 90. But before we do that, let me lead us in prayer. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that you've given us, and we pray that you would help us to still our hearts, help us to listen carefully to your word, help us to adore your majesty rightly, and help us to serve one another in love for Jesus' sake. Amen. Well, why don't we stand together? And we're going to begin with these words. They're an acclamation of God's glory taken from Psalm 90. So let's stand and we'll say these together. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Let's remain standing as we sing together.
Thank you. as we remain standing, we're going to confess together. That's saying sorry to God for the ways that we have not followed His ways this week, listened to Him this week in all of the different ways. Let's do that, because it's right and it's good to do that. So if you would like to repeat the words in bold. Heavenly Father, You love us so much, You gave us Jesus.
We're sorry for loving other things more than You.
Lord Jesus, You love us so much, You died on the cross to save us from our sins.
We're sorry for living for ourselves and forgetting that we belong to You.
Mighty God, You pour Your love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit.
We're sorry for trying to live for You in our own strength. Help us to depend on Your Holy Spirit more and more.
Amen. Why don't we take a seat?
Fantastic. So it is lovely to see you all. My name's Sam. I'm the minister for Trinity at Four. And we are especially pleased to have Harriet Clough here today. Thank you for bringing your parents along with you, Harriet. And indeed some family and godparents. You're all very welcome. And Harriet is going to be baptized today. Now, how old is Harriet? Remind me. Harriet is 11 months old. Now, put your hands up. Do you think 11 months ago, who thinks Harriet had to work really hard in order to be born? Did Harriet have to do anything in order? Hands up if you think Harriet had to do something to be born. Well, when you get to your biology lessons in due course, you will realise that to be born, a child has to do nothing at all. It's a gift. And you know, Jesus says something very interesting in the Bible. He says that if anyone wants to be part of my kingdom, they must be born again. Okay, that means that if we want to be part of Jesus' family and his kingdom forever and ever, then we have to be born again. And just like you can't do anything to bring about the first time you were born, actually you can't do anything to bring about being accepted by God into his forever kingdom. It's a gift of grace. And so when we baptize Harriet in a few moments' time, it isn't the water that means that she can be part of God's kingdom. What we're doing there is we're saying she is welcome into God's family, and we trust and pray that God will do an amazing work in her heart that she might be born again as she grows up into that eternal kingdom and family. So it's a wonderful thing to be able to baptise Harriet today. And I'm going to invite family and the baptism party up to the front. And children, if you want to see what's going on, then why don't you come up and sit down at the front here, and then you can have a good look as well. Okay, and there are going to be some words up on the screen for us to say together as well. Come up here.
And walk with her in the way of Christ. With the help of God, we will.
Today we speak for Harriet. Will you care for her and help her to take her place within the life and worship of Christ's church?
With the help of God, we will.
In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvellous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. Therefore, I ask, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God?
I reject them.
Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbour?
I repent of them.
Do you turn to Christ as Saviour?
I turn to Christ.
Do you submit to Christ as Lord?
I submit to Christ.
I sign you with the sign of the cross. The sign of Christ. Do not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified. Fight valiantly as a disciple of Christ against sin, the world, and the devil, and remain faithful to Christ to the end of your life. So may Almighty God deliver you from the powers of darkness, restore in you the image of his glory, and lead you in the light of obedience to Christ. You have brought Harriet to baptism. You must now declare before God and his church the Christian faith into which she is to be baptized and in which you will help her to grow. You must ask for yourselves and for Harriet. Do you believe and trust in God the Father who made the world?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in his Son Jesus Christ who redeemed mankind?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in his Holy Spirit who gives life to the people of God?
I believe and trust in him.
This is something for all of us here. This is the faith of the church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So, Harriet Felicity, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well done. You do well. There is one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. Harriet, by one Spirit, we are all baptized into one body. We welcome you into the fellowship of the faith. We are children of the same Heavenly Father. We welcome you. Wes, we did a big round of applause. Can I put a little history in here? It's actually quite big. So here's a Bible for you. This is the most important thing that you can read. Get to know Jesus here. I know. You might need mum and dad to help you to start with. And there are some certificates in here as well. Well done. Now listen, you young people can stay here, because in just a minute we are going to go out to our groups. I've just got two things to mention before kids head out. First thing, oh my goodness, I think it's a record of how many of our Christmas, our kind of Christmas flyers have been taken for distribution. So every year we try and distribute our flyers around the whole parish, and I think there are only about 12 or 15 streets left. So it would be amazing if the last ones could go today. There's a big pile of them just at the door on the way out. So if you haven't grabbed one of those yet, do grab one of those. And those of you who have been following life in the Church of England, you'll be aware that there was an important vote in Synod this week. If you have any questions about that, then I would love to talk that through. And I will be saying a bit more about that in due course. But just to flag that as something that if you've got any questions about that, then I'll be really happy to chat those through. But for now, our kids are going to head out for their groups, so I'm going to pray for you all, and then you guys are going to head off and have a wonderful time. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much that you call us to belong to a community, a family, that we've just welcomed Harriet into that family. And as our hugely valued young people head off to their groups, we pray that you'll be teaching them all about Jesus. And we pray for the same for us as we stay here in the service as well. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Right, you lot, time to head off. Down there, if you follow Peter, he will tell you where he's going. And Beacons, you are staying with us today. In fact, I can see you up on the balcony. Well done. We're going to have a great time here today.
George, let's go with Molly. Just as the children go out, let's bow our heads in prayer. And as we think of the troubles of the world in Gaza and Ukraine, the Yemen, Sudan, all the other places in the world where there is conflict, let us in peace pray to the Lord. We pray for the leaders of the nations, that you will guide them in the ways of freedom, justice and truth. We pray for those who bear arms on behalf of their nation, that they may have discipline and discernment, courage and compassion. We pray for our enemies and those who wish others harm, that you will turn the hearts of all to kindness and friendship. We pray for the wounded and the captive, the grieving and the homeless, that in all their trials they may know your love and support. Heavenly Father, hear our prayers for all who strive for peace and all who fight for justice. Help us today as we remember the cost of war to work towards a better tomorrow. And as we commend to you lives lost in terror and conflict, we pray that you will bring us all at the end to the peace of your presence. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And today is the seventh World Day of Prayer for the Poor. So today we pray in particular for the poor and needy in our streets and across the earth, that at all times we may hold out our hands to the poor and open our arms with compassion for the needy, the vulnerable and the abandoned. We pray for all leaders in our society that they may open their eyes to the poverty around them and their minds to new and creative ways of recognising the God-given dignity of all. We pray for a better use of the God-given talents of men and women, that we may be generous with our skills, our gifts, our finances and our time, so as to build up our neighbourhoods in love. And we pray that we who have been entrusted with the riches of the gospel may truly repent of the many times we've buried this treasure, and that we will seek opportunities to bring Jesus to the lives of those around us. Lord, we particularly today thank you for the work of CAP in Henley and pray that you will raise up more helpers in this work to demonstrate your love in practical and meaningful ways. We thank you for Debbie Brewer and pray that you will strengthen and encourage her as she seeks to serve you through this important and life-changing work. And finally, we pray for ourselves. We pray that you will build us up as a church known for its passion for you, its honouring and welcoming of all peoples, its generosity and its love of your creation. And we pray that as individuals, we may demonstrate your love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control in our daily lives, so that in all things and at all times, you may be glorified. So let us join together in the words that you taught us, which are now on the screen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We're going to have our reading from the Bible in just a sec. But because we're starting a new kind of series of four talks over the next kind of run up to Christmas, the next few weeks, just a bit of a kind of intro to that. Stories are a massive part of all of our lives, aren't they? We love stories. Stories basically have two things make a story. Every story has two key things. Meaning. Okay, so a story tells us something that's coherent, something that makes sense. And secondly, direction. So a story, at least I learned in my GCSE English, has a beginning, a middle, and then an end. It takes us somewhere. Something with meaning, something with direction. And we get caught up in a story, and it kind of carries us along with it. We love stories. And you get stories, of course, in all kinds of different shapes and sizes. We get them in the shape of films, of books, of two friends sitting down in a pub saying what happened this last week, or a grandpa after Christmas lunch reminiscing with the grandkids about what it was like when he was young. Stories are everywhere you look. And actually, we all need our lives to be part of a bigger story. For our lives, in other words, to have those two key things, meaning and direction. Our lives aren't just incoherent series of events with no meaning, and equally, our lives are actually going somewhere. They fit within a story. I read an interesting article this week by a lady called Ayan Hirsi Ali. She was a former Muslim who then became one of the new atheists. Kind of, she's very closely aligned with Richard Dawkins and Christopher Hitchens, if you've heard of people like that. And just this last week, she published an essay in provocatively titled, Why I Am a Christian. She's become a Christian. And in that article, she explains a number of things, including this. She says, I was also turned to Christianity because I ultimately found life without any spiritual solace unendurable, indeed very nearly self-destructive. Atheism failed to answer a simple question. What is the meaning and purpose of life? Or to put it another way, what's the story? What's the story that we're all a part of here? Now, the Bible tells the ultimate story. Okay, it's made up of 66 different books written by a whole collection of different authors over millennia. And yet, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Christians believe the Bible tells one coherent story, a beautiful story. It's the story of our world. It's the story of our lives. It's the story that tells us our past and our future. It is the story that makes sense of life for all of us. And for the next 4 weeks, that's what we're going to be doing. We're going to be thinking about what is the story of the whole Bible. As those who come to church regularly know, our practice is to kind of pick a book of the Bible and we're going to work through it gradually. But I thought it'd be helpful just to take a step back, to zoom back, as it were, and see, well, what is the story of the whole
the whole thing. And I've made a pretty diagram for you, which I hope you got on your way in. Don't get lost in the diagram, but this is, you'll see it on the screen there and in your handouts. I tried to line out the chapters of this story as they go across, books of the Bible are kind of lined out underneath. And rather than taking a chunk at a time each week, we're going to do a whole part of the story each week. So today we're going to do the whole story under four different themes each week. Today we're going to be thinking about God, our King. But over the next 4 weeks, it'll be the story of God, our King, our Bridegroom, our Shepherd, and our Father. It's an amazing story. And I think the most amazing thing about it is it's a story that we are part of, and it makes sense of the story of our lives as well. So that's where we go, and that's what we're doing today. And I'm going to now ask Nick to come up and give us our readings as we dive in together the story of the Bible as God our King, who brings his rebellious people into the perfect blessing of his rule. Thank you, Nick.
So the Old Testament reading is taken from 1 Samuel chapter 17 verses 1 to 11, and that can be found on page 288. Now the Philistines gathered their forces for war and assembled at Socah in Judah. They pitched camp at Ephes Damim, between Socah and Azekah. Saul and the Israelites assembled and camped in the valley of Elah and drew up their battle line to meet the Philistines. The Philistines occupied one hill and the Israelites another, with the valley between them. A champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. His height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale armor of bronze, weighing 5,000 shekels. On his legs he wore bronze greaves, and a bronze javelin was slung on his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and its iron point weighed 600 shekels. His shield bearer went ahead of him. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why do you come out and line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not the servants of Saul? Choose a man and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill you, you will become our subjects and serve us." Then the Philistine said, "This day I defy the armies of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other." On hearing the Philistines' words, Saul and all the Israelites were dismayed and terrified. And then on page 289, verses 45 to 50. David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands." As the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag and taking out a stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. So David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone. Without a sword in his hand, he struck down the Philistine and killed him. The New Testament reading is taken from Matthew chapter 4, verses 12 to 17, and that can be found on page 968. When Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he withdrew to Galilee. Leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum, which was by the lake in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali, to fulfill what was said through the prophet Isaiah. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the word of the Lord.
Good, we're back on.
It's a great story, isn't it, Lord of the Rings? And by the time, if he made it through all three films, by the time he gets to that coronation scene, no one is begrudging the crown upon Aragorn's head. Because you've just been through the darkness. You know how bad the darkness is. And what a relief to have a king who will reign with justice and bring people into perfect peace and security. The darkness is gone, it's been banished, and now justice and love and light can rule under the king. It's an amazing story. Our hearts resonate with stories like it. In our dark world, we long for a king like that. I mean, just think about countries around the world with kings who are the opposite of that. Absolute chaos. Think about our own lives. What a mess we so often make of them under our own steam. And how wonderful to have someone who can direct us perfectly and lovingly in the way that we should go and that would lead to our flourishing. Well, the story of the Bible as a whole is an invitation to know such a king and to belong to such a kingdom. So we're going to tell the story in six chapters, okay? And we're going to follow along. That little crown is going to make its way along the chapters. So you will be able to see how we're getting on as we go. So, chapter 1, the King of Love. They opened their eyes from another night's sleep, and what they saw took their breath away. Life in the Garden of Eden was good. Every day of creation ends with the same phrase in Genesis 2. God saw that it was good. But you know, the best thing for Adam and Eve wasn't the wonder of creation, as amazing as it was. It was the God who made it. You get this amazing picture of intimacy. He walked with them in the garden. Genesis 1 and 2, the first books of the Bible, paint a picture of God as our loving king. He is our king. We are his people. And in every way, he behaves like a king. He's a king whose word is powerful. He speaks creation into being. He's a king who created us for a purpose, to work in his good world under his loving rule. He's a king who gave life-giving commands. Be fruitful, he says, and multiply. And you might remember the story of the two trees, and there was one tree, he said, look, don't eat that fruit. Trust me, it won't go well if you do. Obedience to the commands of this king leads to a life of blessing, in which we walk in close relationship with him. Life under the life-giving rule of our loving king. Chapter 2, the King of Justice. But now look and see the sad picture. Adam and Eve walking away from the garden, away from God, away from life, away from blessing, away from the loving rule of their king. What went wrong? There was another voice. This voice said those words. Did God really say? This God, he's a bit of a power freak, isn't he? You know, he rules this, that, and everywhere. All over the place. Rules to restrict you and spoil your sense of autonomy. You can be free from this rule. Just eat the fruit. And they believe the lie. And they discovered that part of God's perfect goodness was his perfect justice. God's perfect justice requires that evil and rebellion is met by righteous judgments. Think about it. Rebellion against a king of perfect love is only ever going to lead to evil, pain, and misery. And that's the sad story as our story continues. It's a sad story of rebellion against a loving king. And so the story continues with Cain and Abel. And of course, Cain kills Abel. And by the time of Noah, God says, look, every inclination of the human heart is evil all of the time. It's a total mess. He has to start again, except there's justice, but with mercy, as Noah is redeemed and rescued and given a fresh start. But the fresh start doesn't fix the fundamental problem, the Tower of Babel in Genesis 11. People again are trying to reach heaven on their own steam, setting up some kind of alternative to God. It's a mess as humanity put the crown on their own heads and hit up against the God of justice. When you rebel against the God of the universe, you meet his justice. And so the picture is a rebellious people living under God's just judgment rather than his blessing. That's what we were made for, the blessing of our loving King. And instead of that, his judgments. Chapter 3, the King's commitment. So just imagine his surprise when Abram, a Mesopotamian idol worshipper, is visited by God himself and given this unconditional commitment. God says, I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you and you will be a blessing, and all people on earth will be blessed through you. Do you see? Three times repeated. Blessing, blessing, blessing. The king's just judgment, the curse, will somehow be turned back to blessing. How? Well, Abraham didn't know. He just had to trust the life of faith in God's promise. That promise, through you, Abraham, my judgment will be turned again to blessing for all peoples. Now that promise came with other aspects as well. I'm going to give you the land. You're going to become a great people. And as the story continues through the Bible, we see God answering some of those promises. So Abraham, against all of the odds, has a son, Isaac. Isaac gives birth to Jacob. Jacob has 12 sons who would eventually become the 12 tribes of Israel. It's a small beginning, but the nation through whom God would bring back blessing to the world had begun. Centuries go by. By this time, God's people have relocated to Egypt because of a famine. They've become a great nation, but tragically, they are now enslaved by a ruthless king, Pharaoh. But God had made a commitment to restore his people to blessing, to bring them into their own land, and had not forgotten that promise. And so he visits Moses and says, I am the Lord, I will free you from being slaves, I will redeem you with an outstretched arm. Here's the promise again, I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. I mean, how are they going to escape the superpower of the day? Well, they can't do it themselves. But God does exactly what he said he was going to do. And so, 10 plagues later, the parting of the Red Sea, and the people, just as God said, are free. God has reaffirmed his promise to Abraham. In spite of your rebellion, I will take you back to my people. We are on a journey from curse back to the blessing of my rule. But as your loving king, you need to learn to live under my just and perfect rule. That's the only pathway to blessing. You've seen what a mess happens when you rebel against the king of love. And so, we get the 10 Commandments. His law summarized in the 10 Commandments, 10 steps to enjoy the blessing of this life-giving rule of God our King. And here's how the situation is summarized later in Deuteronomy. God says, I've set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live, and that you may love the Lord your God, listen to his voice, and hold fast to him, for the Lord is your life. Sadly, like Adam and Eve, within days, the people make their choice. And it's not life. It's rebellion again. And at this point, we're thinking, how will God keep this promise to restore the blessing of his rule when the hearts of his people are so inclined to go the other way? And therefore be met with God's unbendable justice. Chapter 4. The king foretold. Little David couldn't believe it. How could King Saul and the Israelites be so cowardly? Meanwhile, Goliath roars in laughter. He sent a boy to fight me? Well, Israel's soon-to-be king steps forward. His amazing words, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come in the name of the Lord Almighty. And with that, David famously lets fly his 5 smooth stones. And Israel's great enemy lay defeated before them. Now, be it by this stage in the story, God has kept his promise to bring them into a land. They're in the land of Israel. to start with, it doesn't go well. In the book of Judges, there's a repeated refrain. In those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as he saw fit. Chaos. And so God provides them with a king. An unlikely king, David, a king after God's own heart, a king who would step into battle on behalf of his people and lead them to victory. Okay, a king who would love God and bring God's rule and his blessing back to his people. And David, when you read about him, gives us a tantalizing taste of what it might look like for God's people to be restored to his blessing and rule. And God made an astonishing promise to David. He says, when your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, your own flesh and blood. He's the one who will build a house in my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. A coming king has been foretold. Now that's a promise that God's people really would have held on to, because the following days after David's rule really were very bleak. Somehow, though, God was going to restore blessing from judgment through an offspring of Abraham, who was also going to be a human king from David's line. And so the story continues. After David, sadly, rebellious kings leading rebellious people away from God. The kingdom splits north and south. God raises up prophets like Amos and Isaiah to warn his people, but their hearts aren't changed. They continue to rebel against God. And eventually, both north and south kingdoms are led out of the land into exile. And it's a repeat of chapter 2. The God of justice. Just like they were banished from Eden, now they're banished from the promised land. How is this promise going to be kept? You see, the story gets darker and darker. The plight of Israel and all humanity seems hopeless. But as the story gets darker, God's prophets issue more and more amazing promises. And so here is Isaiah. He says, a light is coming. To us a child is born, a son is given. And he'll be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. At the greatest of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne. Do you see? Isaiah says, don't forget the promise. Blessing is going to be restored. The blessing promised to Abraham through a descendant of David. It's coming. The king is coming. It looks dark, but the light is going to dawn. Jeremiah says this. This is the covenant I will name with the people of Israel after that time. I'll put my law into their minds and write it onto their hearts. How is God going to keep this promise to restore blessing of his rule when the hearts of his people are so inclined to rebel against him? And Jeremiah says, this is how. He's going to come and change your hearts. This promised king, that's what he's going to do. Chapter 5, the servant king. It was an explosive announcement after centuries of anticipation. His voice was like the promise of spring after a long, long winter. The time has come. Jesus says, the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Jesus says the kingdom has come near. And the reason for that is because the king has arrived. And when you read about Jesus, he has all the authority of the King of Love we met in the garden. He has a word that commands creation. He has a word that brings blessing. He has teaching that people are hanging on every word because it comes with such obvious life-giving authority. The king is here. The member of Abraham's family who would restore God's blessings to the nations, the direct descendant of King David who will rule on an eternal throne, the longed-for great light of Isaiah who would shine in the darkness, the one who will take away the curse and restore blessing and change our very hearts. He's here. The kingdom of God is at hand, says Jesus. But how would he do it? How would Jesus do what no one else had managed? How would he restore us from death and judgment that God's justice requires for our rebellion to the life of blessing that God's love desired for us? How would he do it? Would he ride into Jerusalem as a conquering king? Horses and all? Would he launch a political coup? He would do it by taking his crown. And it wasn't the kind of crown you would expect. It was a crown of thorns. He was dressed in a purple robe, signifying royalty. The soldiers mocked him and beat him. And notice was hung across upon the cross where they killed him. It said mockingly but correctly, "The King." The King. The King. And here's why he did that there for you. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, "Cursed is everyone who is hung on a pole." He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Oh my goodness, those verses have such promise for us. Do you see the curse, the judgment that the whole story so far has been grappling with? Jesus says, "I will bear it for you." The King of Kings, the King of Love, who created the world, steps into the world he created and says, "My love overflows so much for you that I will bear the curse in your place. My incomprehensible love will shield my people from what you deserve. The curse that has been with us ever since Genesis 3, I will bear it for you." And Jesus invites those who trust him to receive his blessing. The curse is gone. I bore it. If you trust in me, you can now be restored to blessing. You see how amazing this is? On the day that Jesus died on the cross, his perfect love and his perfect justice embraced. Justice met as Jesus pays the price. Love poured out as we receive the blessing. You see, King Jesus, he stood like David before Goliath. A Goliath we can never defeat. The Goliath of our sin and the death it deserves. Like David, he strode forward on behalf of us all. He walked not into the shadow of a giant, but into the shadow of death itself. And there, 3 days later, he rose again. And as Goliath lay dead at David's feet, now death lies completely defeated at Jesus' feet, our King, who strides into battle on our behalf. We, I'm afraid, in this story, we are not dead. We are cowering Israelites who are too afraid and unable to do anything. But the Messiah, the promised King, the seed of Abraham, the promised one in the line of David has come. He's triumphed over the greatest enemy for us. He's alive as the everlasting King that was promised. Chapter 6, the reign of the King. After his resurrection, this King of Kings ascended into heaven and sat at the right hand of God. And he has poured out the gift of his Holy Spirit. And by the power of that Spirit, his kingdom is growing and growing and growing across the face of the world. Friends, this is the part of the story that we're in. We've seen it for the last 2,000 years. As men, women, and children from every nation come to see Jesus as the King who loves us and who invites us to belong to his perfect kingdom. It was the last instruction that Jesus gave All authority, this is kingly language, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, because that's the way of blessing, to live under the rule of the King. And surely I'm with you always, to the very end of the age. Friends, this is the part of the story we're still in. There's an invitation to step away from the curse of judgment and receive every blessing by belonging to our King Jesus. To repent and believe the good news. To take the crown off your own head and put it firmly on the head of Jesus, who, when you do, floods your heart with his love through the Holy Spirit. He speaks with you personally through the Bible. He leads you faithfully into his everlasting kingdom. And just as Jeremiah promised, when you come to Jesus, you are given a new heart, a soft heart, a heart with God's law written on it, so that you want to go your way, and he empowers you to go his way. And as you do, you begin even now to experience the blessing of living under the rule of the King who loves you. Now, the end of the story hasn't happened yet, but God's told us exactly what to expect. The King will return. Satan will be banished. Final justice will be done. And if we haven't asked our King to bear the judgment we deserve at the cross, then we will have to bear it ourselves forever. But for those who have sought refuge in Jesus, we will be brought into the perfect blessing of his everlasting kingdom, where, look at these last words, some of the last words in the Bible, no longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face. No longer any curse, only blessing forever and ever. So that's the choice before all people. Without Jesus, eternal judgment of his righteous wrath. With Jesus, eternal blessing of his loving rule. And so those words that God spoke to Moses, he speaks to us. Choose life. Choose life. Make Jesus your king if you haven't already. Don't believe Satan's lie that his rule is restrictive or oppressive. Seek the work of his Spirit to live joyfully and wholeheartedly under his rule. Listen to, read, and obey his words. Allow King Jesus to shape every area of your life, your relationships, your finance, your commitments, your aspirations. Resist allowing the darkness of our world to shape you, for he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. What an amazing story. What an amazing Savior. Let's pray. Our Father, thank you for King Jesus. Thank you for this amazing story of the whole Bible, of a King who brings us back to the blessing of his rule. And how we pray that we would willingly, joyfully submit to the rule of our King of love, our Lord Jesus. And we ask it for his glory. Amen. Our young people are going to come back in for communion whilst we stand and sing our next song together. Let's stand and sing, crowned him with many crowns. Thank you.
Well, as we stand, we're going to say some words all together. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord. It is right to give thanks and praise. Well, do please take a seat. Welcome back, young people. We're very pleased to have you here again. Now, we're going to share some bread and some wine together. And as we do that, I wonder if any of the young people can tell me, what do we remember when we share bread and wine? Jojo. That's right, Jesus dying on the cross. Okay, the bread stands for his body and the wine stands for his blood. And it's a reminder that he loves us so much that he gave his very life for us. Now, children, we would love you to come up and receive a prayer. If your parents think that you're old enough to be trusting in Jesus and to understand what we're doing in communion, then you're welcome to take the bread and the wine. And parents, if you're unsure about that, do have a chat with me or with Peter. I would love to help you think that one through as well. Anyone is welcome to communion who is trusting in Jesus as their King and seeking to walk in his ways. But before we get to that, there are some words that we're going to work through together, which are kind of come up on the screen here. So accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and blood, who in the same night he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. To you be glory and praise forever." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." To you be glory and praise forever. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom. And with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Amen. If for whatever reason you prefer to stay where you are sitting, please feel no embarrassment about doing that at all. Our kind of welcome team will usher you a row at a time. And if you're on the back three rows, then if you go round the back, then there's going to be a station just through the doors. So if you go around there and then kind of come back, just the back three should be plenty on that. And if I could just invite those helping me to serve to come up to the front now. Thank you. Thank you. Say together, we say, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us by faith with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to stand and sing a final hymn together. Let's stand and sing. Thank you.
Well, we've reached the end of our service this afternoon. The doors at the back are now locked, just to keep the children safe. So if you want to go out, it's through these doors. And do stick around for tea, coffee, some refreshments, and food for the kids as well. But as we close, let me lead us in prayer. Loving Father, thank you for Jesus, our great King. And we pray that we would indeed choose life in Jesus' kingdom, that we would take refuge under the shelter of the arms of our King, stretched wide at the cross of Calvary, and await that day when we will see him on his throne. For Jesus' sake, amen.